Enjoyed your lunch, and I hope you enjoyed the morning sessions. I think there's a few of us that are still going to be out discussing with Wendy about volunteer solutions for their volunteer futures. At this time, we have one of the most important talks of the whole conference on hospitality and how to understand hospitality. We're in ministries of hospitality, we often say, and so we have a world expert on what hospitality is all about, and especially what Scripture has to say about hospitality. And to introduce our speaker, I've asked Deacon Paul Rosenblum to introduce her. So welcome, thank you.
Thanks, Jason. One of the first things we heard about during the homily at our opening worship was hospitality. We were encouraged, perhaps even admonished, to keep that at the center of our attention. And since that time, we've spent a lot of effort discussing lots of very interesting topics: seafarers' rights to shore leave, how to build better boards of directors, how to raise more money for our ministries, how to attract more volunteers, all of which, of course, are necessary for us to do the job that we are really called to do. And so it seems at this point, as we near the end of our time together, to come full circle and focus again on that, what is really the central core mission that we have, and that is hospitality. And so I'm pleased to introduce our speaker today, Jessica Robleski, who is an assistant professor of theology at Wheeling Jesuit University. She's going to speak to us on making hospitality ordinary, which really means infusing hospitality into everything we do. And I wanted to, we do have, if you've seen out on the table, her book published 2 years ago. And I wanted to just read one of the testimonials from it, because I think it sums up quite a bit well what it means and what hospitality is, and her take on it. And rooted in a deep desire to strengthen the practice of Christian hospitality, this book provides an insightful and incisive look at some of its limits and tensions. Jessica Robleski thoughtfully weaves together personal narrative, theoretical material, and practical wisdom in addressing the central challenges in offering welcome. Because that's what we're all called to do, this is probably, I can't think of a more appropriate way to really wrap up our session here this week. Jessica.
It's very good to be with all of you, and I'm appreciative to Sharon and to Jason for the invitation. I'm fascinated by the work that you do. I am living in West Virginia, so we don't have any major seaports, although the city that I'm currently living in, Wheeling, is on the Ohio River, and I understand that back in the day, it actually was a major thoroughfare for traffic of the steel industry and the coal industry throughout the United States. So again, I'm fascinated to learn about the work that you do, and I am delighted to be here. And I hope that what I have to share today will be of some value to you, both in terms of framing the work that you do and framing the conversations that you've had over the past few days, encouraging you further in your work, and then perhaps also hopefully offering a few practical suggestions for living into this ministry of hospitality. One thing that people, I was noticing, I brought the little placard from my room down, because the Holiday Inn actually has a hospitality promise that it makes note of in our bathrooms. And the promise is, making your stay a complete success is our goal. Just let our manager on duty or front desk staff know if any part of your stay isn't satisfactory. We promise to make it right, or you won't pay for that part of your stay. I bring this down and I begin with this because I think it points to some of the ways in which hospitality is a term that's been diluted and in some ways distorted by our contemporary consumer culture and our entertainment industry. So hospitality is a word that, and if you just Google hospitality, you're much more likely to come up with something that has to do with the hotel and restaurant industry. Than something that has to do with reaching out to strangers, reaching out to those who are maybe vulnerable or those who are marginalized within society. So a number of people who currently write on the practice of hospitality say the first thing that we need to do is to clarify what this term means in its Judeo-Christian context. Apart from what it means in our contemporary kind of consumerist, entertainment-based society, where hospitality is about the satisfaction of the customer satisfaction, right? Or you don't pay. It's something that is part of an economic exchange. It is something that is about kind of putting on special extras, rolling out the red carpet, as it were, maybe having a special room. I haven't been to the hospitality room sponsored by MoneyGram yet. But, you know, these are the connotations that hospitality often has within our world today, which are all, I mean, nothing evil or terrible about that. But that's not what hospitality is about in the context of biblical faith and of ministry. So as it's been practiced throughout human history and culture, hospitality has a far deeper and broader significance than this. So in the ancient world and in many cultures today, the way in which strangers, so not just friends and not customers, but those who are strangers and those who are vulnerable, the way in which strangers are received is seen as one of the pillars of morality upon which the universe stands. And that's in the words of a New Testament scholar, John Koenig, who's written on this topic. So the welcome that is offered to strangers, not simply family and neighbors, is what was seen to distinguish civilized people from barbarians. There were a number of reasons for the significance of hospitality within the ancient world and, again, within many cultures today. Part of this has to do with the vulnerability of travelers, the ways in which kinship groups and local communities were important to the physical safety of people. The difficulty of travel, so, you know, the lack of access to you know, to the ease of air travel and the comforts that we typically enjoy and the freedoms that we have with using cars or even the kinds of modern technologies with seafaring that we have today. But then there was also a vision of strangers as a kind of divine emissary, someone who is sent from the gods. Someone who is sent as a gift, as a messenger in some ways, as a representative of the divine. And a people's morality was shown, their humanity was shown in some ways by the ways in which those strangers were treated before they were even known. So probably at some point you all have encountered Homer's Odyssey. Certainly a great classic of seafaring journey and adventure, but also a classic in terms of thinking about what hospitality means, the significance of hospitality within the ancient world. And so in Odysseus's journeys, we see how he is received in some cases hospitably, and in other cases, notably this with the Cyclops, his encounter with the Cyclops, that hospitality is distorted or violated. And this was a teaching text in some ways for the ancients who saw, once again, these practices as a significant mark of humanity and of friendship. Within the Judeo-Christian tradition, beginning with the figure of Abraham, again, one of the kind of classic stories within the biblical tradition is this idea, this story from Genesis 18. And this is actually something that is notable not just within the Christian tradition, but also within the Judaic tradition. There's also a version of this story in the Quran. So Abraham is sitting at his tent in the heat of the day, and he sees these strangers walk up. And he goes out from his tent, and there's been lots of rabbinic commentary on the significance of his going out and how hospitality is not just a kind of sitting back and waiting for people to come to us, but actually going forth and meeting them and trying to address their needs before we may even know who they are or what they're about. So this is really challenging in a lot of ways. So scholars of ancient Christian hospitality differ in some ways over whether or not there was anything really distinctive about Christian practices of hospitality in contrast with other Near Eastern cultures. But there are several passages within the Gospels that do point to a kind of significance within the Christian tradition that may or may not have been shared by the surrounding cultures. So Christian scripture and tradition give particular attention, for one thing, to those who are most powerless, those who are in some cases most undesirable or have the least to offer in return. So again, a contrast with our contemporary cultural understandings of you get what you pay for. You know, the hospitality of luxury hotels is lavish, but you have to have the credit card to make sure that you can pay for that in return. So in contrast, in Luke 14, Jesus tells his listeners, when you give a banquet, invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, and the blind, and you will be blessed because they cannot repay you, for you will be repaid at the resurrection of the just. So this inclusive welcome that is proclaimed and extended by Jesus is a defining feature of the kingdom of God, especially within the Gospel of Luke, but in other places as well. And of course, you know, this very famous, often quoted scripture from Matthew 25, where Jesus is speaking to the righteous at the judgment. And the king says to those on his right, you know, I was hungry and you gave me food. I was thirsty and you gave me drink. I was a stranger and you welcomed me. I was naked and you clothed me. He goes on. And then when they express confusion, when did we do this? He says, whatever you did for the least of these, you did for me. So there's a deepening within these early Christian traditions of the significance of welcome to the least, those who are on the margins, those who are powerless and vulnerable. Because it's not just that the stranger is a representative of the gods, of the divine, but Jesus himself identifies with that person who is away from home, away from what is familiar. So hospitality is important, but it can also be exhausting and even dangerous. So I actually begin the book with, and my interest in this topic actually grew out of my own experience of living in a community that was trying to practice hospitality to those who were on the margins, to those who were homeless, to those who were simply in a difficult place in life. And in this house, this is just a kind of intentional community within graduate school, there were different visions of what we could sustain and what we couldn't. And after a few days of taking more and more people in, the seams started to kind of pull apart, and the strain on our community became so great that people within it, those who were sort of native and trying to offer welcome to others, felt threatened, felt that it was an inhospitable place to them. And so this kind of got me thinking, okay, maybe for the sake of hospitality itself, there need to be certain kinds of limits, that our human finitude requires that we sometimes close the door. And I found that troubling, at the same time as necessary. So, the question that occupies much of my work is how can we best practice the inclusive and radical hospitality that is demonstrated and promoted in the Gospels, given the finitude and vulnerability of our human existence. So if God's eschatological welcome in Jesus should serve as the paradigm for Christian hospitality, our limits, you know, sort of saying, look, here are our resources, or this is what our community can sustain and these things it can't. Are these simply a concession to weakness or even sin? And again, after struggling a while with this, I came to the conclusion that these limits should not solely be understood negatively. So I'm at the limits of my resources. I have no more time to give. We have no more space to give. We have no more money to provide. There's no more we can do. Those are certainly experiences that we face in all kinds of ministry. But there are also ways in which the enclosure of a welcome also requires boundaries. The safety of a welcome requires certain kinds of boundaries. So this idea of welcome implies welcome into something that can be distinguished from what is outside of it, right? The idea of having a safe space, a safe and friendly space, to use Henry Nouwen's terminology, depends in some ways upon having boundaries where we can assure guests that there is a certain amount of safety. The key here is always maybe maintaining this tension between openness and boundedness. So it can't become all about the limits, because otherwise one loses the sort of spirit of generosity and spontaneity and openness to what is unknown. But if there are absolutely no boundaries at all, then that meaning, or that welcome itself, loses some of its meaning. So the particularity of a welcome in some cases is part of what makes it meaningful. You go into somebody's house and it's distinguished, it's distinct from what is on the street. And that's part of what makes that noteworthy. Again, I often refer to Henry Nouwen's work for those of you who don't know Nouwen, he was a Catholic writer in the 20th century. And he speaks about having an articulate presence to the guest, that there's a certain amount of emptiness and openness that is necessary, but at the same time, no one wants to be welcomed into a home where no one is present. So it's, again, maintaining this tension between being who we are and being present and being particular, while also being open to those things that may challenge, those things that may be unfamiliar to us. In terms of physical resources, and I think that this is just at a pragmatic, practical level, probably where most people feel the strain, where you just feel exhausted, right? You know, there are no more emotional resources. There's no more financial resources. How do we actually address the needs that are present to us? And there may be times when that finitude does feel tragic. We wish we could do more. I've certainly many times over the past few weeks, as the stories of the child refugees, the young refugees coming to America. You know, the complexities of those problems, the complexities of many people's problems. I spent a lot of time with Catholic worker communities. So these are not simple. But I think that, and again, drawing from the Catholic worker, drawing from Henry Nouwen, there's a way in which a simple presence, even if we can't meet all of the needs that are before us, we can meet the people who are before us. And there can be a practice of affirming a person, even if we're not able to do all that we can, or all that they need, or all that we might like. So even this, when we have to say no, such and so is not safe. We can't we don't have the resources to address a particular need. That should in some ways be informed and shaped by a spirit of hospitality that affirms the other and affirms a relationship there. Again, even when we can't do everything that we might like. So in the book, I offer several different suggestions for how to kind of cultivate this spirit of hospitality. The idea of our ministry is in some ways always having a posture of openness, always having a disposition of openness, but also an ability to discern boundaries, an ability to in some ways enforce boundaries and take time for self-care. Because without that, that hospitality tends to erode. The work of Dorothy Day and the Catholic Worker, which there's a chapter in the book that deals with that tradition, that movement more specifically, I think is very instructive in this regard. And it may seem like the Catholic Worker is a crazy place to look for just talk about boundaries and limits in hospitality. The Catholic Worker, for those of you who are not familiar with this movement, grew out of a desire to take the gospel mandate seriously, to actually say, you know, if you have two coats, and you see a brother in need, you know, give him your coat. Open your home to those who are poor, to those who are in need. And so beginning with a house of hospitality and a soup kitchen in New York City in the 1930s and spreading to many other places around the country, this idea of offering bread, of offering comfort, of offering shelter to those in need, you know, has been a nationwide and in some ways worldwide influential movement. But Dorothy Day and others who followed her were very aware of their own limits, were aware of the fact that you sometimes needed to retreat, sometimes needed to pull back from the ministry so that it would be possible to be present. So, you know, again, we can probably all think of circumstances, maybe in ministry, maybe simply when we have family members and other guests in our own homes, where you try to be patient and you try to be patient and you try to be patient, and you find yourself kind of snapping. So this tension between hospitality and hostility sometimes sometimes breaks and becomes overt if we aren't able to discern those boundaries, to find ways of taking time so that, again, we're not just trying to meet needs in the abstract, but actually meeting people and being present to people. So I try to offer a number of suggestions in the book for ways to recognize and respect these kinds of limits and boundaries while also trying to expand them, also trying to open ourselves more fully to other people and to their needs. So one of these, and I think a very, very important one, a kind of practical resource for expanding the limits of hospitality involves precisely the kind of work that you guys are doing in meeting at this conference. And by that, I mean coming together in community. When we join together with other people, our the resources that we have at our disposal, the gifts that we have to bring to the table, and simply the physical material kinds of resources that are available to us are multiplied. But I think that also, a sense of solidarity, a sense of support, a sense of common struggle, a sense of, look, I understand, that's hard. And when this happens, that's difficult, and here's how I've dealt with that. So joining together in community can be a way of overcoming vulnerabilities and multiplying resources. Another way, and actually I think I want to talk about several different dimensions of this, is thinking about spiritual disciplines. What I'm trying to get at, I think, more broadly in kind of talking about, look, we've got this tension between boundedness and openness. Hospitality is lost in some ways if everything is completely open and we have no sense of what we're welcoming people into, a place of peace in contrast to maybe the tumultuousness of the world around them. But it can't just be all about that protection. So the ability to discern those boundaries depends on cultivating certain kinds of virtues. There's no algorithm for how to decide these kinds of questions. And so the ability to make these kinds of practical decisions well is not just a matter of following rules or looking to a kind of set of guidelines for, okay, this has happened, now we close the door. Sometimes those may be necessary, but more often, we need to develop ourselves, our character as people, so that we're able to be sensitive to the needs of others and to our own needs. And through a set of spiritual disciplines, and I actually offer five different kind of pairings in the book of spiritual disciplines that cultivate both gratitude and discernment, that cultivate a kind of generosity, but also care and also prudence. So the first of these I describe as the prayer of word and prayer of silence. So Henry Nouwen, in Reaching Out, and by the way, I'm quite indebted to Richard Foster for all of these disciplines and for the language of discipline. So a spiritual discipline is not just something that we do when we feel like it. We're moved to pray at a particular point, and so we do it. But rather something that we're committed to, something that that we decide and commit to practicing day in, day out, whether we feel like it or not. And it's in that committed practice that ourselves are shaped in new ways. So Nouwen writes that the paradox of prayer is that it asks for a serious effort while it can only be received as a gift. We cannot plan, organize, or manipulate God, but without careful discipline, we cannot receive him either. And so I think that this idea, this paradox, is important. In our very, very busy lives and very often, just full to the brim lives, it can be very important to carve out spaces where we're able to hear and receive God's spirit and God's wisdom in our lives. So by prayer of word, I mean what we typically think of as intercessory prayer, as liturgical prayer. And I think that this is important because often our anxieties and our fears and our concerns lay kind of implicit below the surface. And by articulating these things through prayer, we're able to kind of examine them and bring them out to the light. And that can make it much more, much better to deal with on a kind of practical level. This can also be a way of, as I was saying before, joining together in community and kind of recognizing common needs, common struggles, common resources. But the prayer of silence, this is not always something that we think about, except in perhaps kind of contemplative traditions, or if you have a tradition of meditation, a practice of meditation. Roger Vandenbush, who is from the Quaker tradition, writes that silence is an important way of developing listening practices with other humans, of really hearing others' opinions and stories in all their complexity, rather than soundbite synopses that we can quickly digest and incorporate into our own narrative. And so I think that in light of hospitality and what hospitality means in terms of truly receiving and recognizing and being present to another person, the ability to kind of silence ourselves and really listen, the development of this skill and capacity in our spiritual lives is something that transfers into our relationships with other human beings. I think especially in given some of the dynamics of contemporary culture that I was mentioning earlier, our very high speed, media saturated, you know, there's always noise and sound bites, things going on all around. It can be very important to be able to turn it off and just listen, to be able to tolerate the silence. So first, that, as I was saying, prayer of word and prayer of silence. Second, the pairing of fellowship and solitude. And hopefully there's something kind of obvious about the ways in which both of these play into and form a framework, a spiritual disposition that that is good for hospitality. By fellowship, I mean something broader than what we typically mean by community. So a community, you know, is a group of people who are oriented around a kind of common purpose, a common place, a common task. Fellowship may be something that is more spontaneous, more broad, but it, again, involves being present with other people for their own sake. So getting out of a kind of instrumentalizing way of thinking about relationships and interactions, what can this do for me, but simply being able to enjoy others for their own sake. But solitude is also an important part of being a hospitable person, being at home in oneself. In reaching out, which from now and which I quoted just a minute ago, he talks about how he describes these three movements of the spiritual life. The first he talks about has to do with our self-relation. And he says there's a movement from loneliness to solitude. So there's something in the human condition that causes us to crave fellowship with others, to seek something that can kind of fulfill our loneliness, that can fill our sense of isolation. And what Nouwen says is, unsurprisingly, it's only God that can truly do that. And that part of moving towards that kind of spiritual wholeness involves recognizing, finding solitude, a kind of sense of peace in oneself and by oneself. And it's from that place of solitude that we're able to really meaningfully reach out to others in hospitality. So it's not a reaching out that is a clinging to someone to try to fulfill all my unmet needs, to make me feel worthwhile or to distract me from my loneliness. But I can actually give in service when I'm able to feel at home in myself and in this solitude. A third pairing is that of celebration and fasting. The spiritual discipline of fasting is something that is present in just about every religious tradition. And it doesn't necessarily need to be a total fasting from food. It may mean kind of turning off the television or turning off the Facebook or something that allows us to carve out space to really perceive our own needs, but also cultivate empathy for those who go without. Those who go without food, those who go without a lot of the luxuries that we take for granted in our lives. But celebration is also an important part of hospitality. I think that while it can be a mistake to think that hospitality has to be a lavish party, a kind of entertainment, a la Martha Stewart, the celebration of the presence of a guest by kind of offering one's best, by saying this is a special occasion because we are together, can also be important to extending welcome. So developing sensitivity to when is an appropriate time to weep, or to laugh, or to mourn, or to dance is an important part of extending and discerning hospitality. So not every instance of hospitality is celebratory, but our ability to set aside work and mundane tasks to celebrate the presence of a guest is important to this. Service and rest, again, a fourth pairing. Service has obvious connections to hospitality. By cultivating ways of serving others, by developing our capacities in that regard, in just very, very practical know-how kinds of ways, we're better able to serve. Richard Foster, in Celebration of Discipline, which I'd mentioned a while earlier, particularly emphasizes the dimension of hidden service as something that we should deliberately cultivate. So there's a tendency in our kind of prideful selves to always want recognition. You know, I mean, like, I'm happy to serve, but I want to be recognized for the service that I'm doing. And again, that's not necessarily anything wrong per se with that. But the development of character depends in some ways on doing service for its own sake in kind of hidden and small ways. So Foster particularly recommends kind of deliberately seeking out ways of serving that aren't going to be seen, ways that maybe aren't going to be noticed. And I've noticed this is a challenging thing to do. Rest may not seem like a spiritual discipline, but I would submit that for many of us, it is as difficult to get ourselves to slow down and rest as it is to extend ourselves and go forward. Busyness, and there's some really interesting writing out there on the kind of culture of busy, and how busy is almost a synonym for our feeling important. How are you doing? I'm busy. Everything is crazy. Busy, 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 you know. And in some cases, that's true. But deliberately kind of seeking out spaces of rest, whether it's keeping a Sabbath or an afternoon time for a walk or something like this, where we're able to stop, in some ways is humbling. I think cultivates a certain amount of humility, but also leads to that ability, as I've mentioned several times already, to be present to another person. You know, the story of Martha and Mary is a classic hospitality story. And it's one where, you know, there are lots of meanings that we can draw out of that. But this idea that hospitality is all about making sure everything is just so and making sure the food's on the table and the house is clean, maybe misses something that we could find only by resting, by stopping, by slowing down and being present to another person. And then finally, fifth, the practice of confession and forgiveness. And I don't necessarily mean a kind of sacramental confession, making a habit of acknowledging to ourselves and to others the places where maybe our hospitality has been imperfect or even failed. And by acknowledging that and in some ways accepting that, we're able to find peace within our limits, to not necessarily say, I'm not going to do anything because I can't do everything, but to recognize, again, our human strengths in the midst of our frailty and our finitude. So finally, and I don't want to take us to, I know we started a little bit late, but I'm going to try to make sure we can finish mostly on time. The one thing that I've been thinking about recently, and actually the title of this talk has kind of had double meaning. Part of it is making hospitality ordinary, in the sense that Paul mentioned of just having it being woven into the fabric of our lives, that we are making space for God, trying to receive God in hospitality through these spiritual practices, trying to receive others, and trying to kind of discern how best to practice hospitality. But I also refer to this, the season, which liturgical season that we are in the midst of right now, the season of ordinary time. And I realize that this is an ecumenical group, and not everyone comes from a tradition that kind of marks out the liturgical seasons. My own tradition, I'm coming from the Roman Catholic tradition, and in the past months and years, my own appreciation for the kinds of rhythms that are cultivated by the observance of these liturgical seasons has been deepened. What we find, I mean, in hospitality and in lots of other ways, is that there are different seasons of our lives, that there are seasons where we feel maybe strained, maybe we have to be sacrificial, where we are thinking about our lives in a penitential way. There are times of celebration and rejoicing, but most of our lives are somewhere in between, this kind of ordinary time. So in most traditions that that observe a kind of liturgical cycle, ordinary time lasts for 33 or 34 weeks of the year, so the majority of the year. According to the 1969 general norms for the liturgical year, during this time, quote, no particular aspect of the life of Christ is celebrated, but rather the mystery in all its fullness. So it may seem less exciting in some ways than when we have a special theme to think about during Lent or Pentecost or the Easter season or Christmas. But there's also a way in which this is the time when we observe the fullness of Christ's life and ministry, and can grow to be more attentive to the different rhythms that are present in our everyday lives when it may not seem like there's anything dramatic taking place. I know from my own experience, sometimes those are the most challenging times. And I can only imagine for those who you minister to, who spend long times, long periods at sea, where there may or may not be any perceivable change in their surroundings, having some way of kind of counting these days and discerning these spiritual rhythms within that space, maybe through going through the lectionary, maybe through other ways of kind of counting, we can better be able to find the presence of Christ within that ordinary time. The name of the season actually does not come from this kind of sense of hospitality being the season being mundane or boring, but it is this idea of an ordo, an order of counted weeks. So this idea of kind of progress, slow and sustained growth, can actually be in some ways what the theme and what the meaning of ordinary time is. those of you who are coming from liturgical traditions maybe know that the color of vestments and that is associated with this period is green. And so I'm from a temperate climate, and this time of year is when we see this kind of sustained growth in the trees, where things, it's not necessarily a dramatic or anything overnight that can be rushed, but something that is about, again, developing ordinary everyday practices over time in the day-to-day. So an essay titled Celebrating the Dash of Ordinary Time by Mary Amore cites a poem by Linda Jones to point to the importance of this time. Between the dramatic events of birth and death. And she highlights this. She says, this is the poem by Jones. I read of a man who stood to speak at the funeral of a friend. He referred to the dates on the tombstone from the beginning to the end. He noted, first came the day of her birth and spoke of the following date with tears. But he said what mattered most was the dash between those years. And I think that this is a kind of lovely image, and this is what I'm going to kind of close with here, is, you know, the dash, not just in the sense of the punctuation that, you know, separates the kind of notable events in our lives, but also the ways in which it may seem we just go from one thing to the next. And what I want to submit is that in what may seem like the humdrum day-to-day cycles and periods of our lives, I want to encourage you and myself to not simply go through the motions and wait and feel like we're waiting for the next big change and event, but to kind of deepen our practices and utilize these opportunities to try to cultivate this kind of spirit of hospitality, a spirit of discernment that is able to recognize and to reach those who are most in need. So thank you. Should I stay up here for questions or?
Well, first of all, let me thank you, Jessica, for a very interesting and stimulating and thought-provoking talk. I think you've pointed out what, for me, is a fault of my own that I think many of us have to deal with, and that is this tendency to try to do too much. We don't personally set our boundaries very well enough. I know myself, I get to the end of a busy day and I, instead of thinking about all the things I did well, I think of all of the things that I failed to do. And that's not healthy. And you've given me some things to think about. Any other questions from the floor? Any comments that we'd like to make?
Doing a plenary, and she used this image that has stuck with me ever since, and that is, you know, when we go on an airplane, they always tell you that the first thing you need to do is put on the oxygen on yourself before you assist, you know, the infants, and thank you for that ongoing gift, because I often refer to that in my own journey, and I think I always tell others, too, that a lot of port chaplaincy, I think, is a lot of it is graciously having to say no to people. You know, they want so much from you. They want, you know, a certain card that you may not have on you, the phone card, or a certain trip that they want to take, and you can't do that and serve other seafarers at the same time, and it wears on you. It really does. So I just keep remembering that image. And now every time I go on an airplane and they tell me that, I applaud them.
Jason.
Question. You gave 5 points, and I was trying to write them down, and somehow I missed the second one. It was began self-relationship, and then you had celebration, but you had something in between.
So the five pairs that I gave were prayer of word and prayer of silence.
Yeah, but this is down further. I got those.
Fellowship and solitude, celebration and fasting.
Okay. Service and something.
Service and rest.
Okay.
And confession and forgiveness.
Thank you so much for your talk. I really appreciate it. And I've been reading the book, and I don't know if anyone else has had a chance to, but she not only gives these wonderful theories, but then weaves them together with personal stories that are actually very touching. So I recommend that as well. And thinking about stories and the personal stories people have been sharing about Port Ministry during this wonderful conference that I've been so pleased to be a part of, one story that I've been attentive to in people who care for others, that is chaplains, but also first responders, people who work in stressed regions of the world, so relief workers. One story that I've been attentive to is something that's called compassion fatigue. Has anyone heard of this? Compassion fatigue. Have you all talked about this already in some context here at NAMA? So my question to you is, in compassion fatigue, one of the symptoms is a shutting down of the generosity muscle, right? So I don't want to be hospitable anymore. I can't open the doors anymore. I don't want to have to deal with you anymore because my cup runneth over and it's with tears. Does that basically describe compassion fatigue to those of you who have looked at it before? So, coming from your theological background, what's the solution to that? What's the remedy for that? I hear you talking about almost prophylactic activities, which are these spiritual disciplines, but what's the remedy for people who are stuck there? Thanks.
I'm wary of remedy in a sense of cure, but if we think about kind of remedy as ongoing treatment and strengthening, it's a great question. I mean, by the way, I really appreciate what you asked. I think that I understand the spiritual disciplines to be both prophylactic, as you put it, but also curative or restorative. And so at the risk of being too simplistic, I would say that finding comfort and strength and rest in receiving the compassion of others. Finding support in other friendships, allowing ourselves to be ministered to, which can sometimes be challenging, I think. Maybe the temptation is to just shut down and close oneself off from connectedness. You know, I can't reach out. I don't feel generous and compassionate any longer. And that results, and here I'm kind of speaking from my own experience, in just wanting to go sit in my room and close all the doors. When